Tune in to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. We have Kyle Ruddy back from HashiCorp, who's going to tell us about the new Azure Provider version 3.0. So tune in. Welcome to this week's episode of the DevOps Lab. And we're back talking about some great Terraform stuff. And with us this week, we have Kyle Ruddy. Welcome back, Kyle.
Hey, thank you very much for having me again.
I'm really excited to have you here because we have another Terraform update that you're going to share with us. So what have you been up to since the last time you were on the show?
Absolutely. So we've been doing some joint work with you all to release a brand new provider, a brand new update to the Azure provider with some really exciting new stuff that's in there that I'm looking really forward to showing off.
Awesome. Well, go ahead, take it away, and let's see what's in the new provider update.
Awesome. So let's switch over to my demo screen here. And one of the big things about the Azure 3.0 provider release is the way that we manage functions within Azure. So what we have here is a look at the way that we used to manage our functions with Terraform here. We can see down here towards the bottom, we have our Azure Function app that calls out a couple of things that are going to be notable in the update, such as we're using an OS type of Linux. We have a couple application settings there, and then our site configuration. But the biggest and most notable part down here is actually how do we get our function published out to Azure to our application? And that's one of the big parts that's changed. So let's switch over to our new configuration. It's going to be using some of the resources that are available in the 3.0 release of the Azure provider. And we're actually going to first start off with, let's just create a new function here. We're going to use a brand new function here. Just go ahead and create this. We're going to store this out into our, let's create a new folder called basic function. Select that, and we're going to use some defaults here, just recreating that Python application that we were using previously. So there we have Visual Studio Code is going out using that extension to create our function for us. There we have it. And what we want to do here is we're actually going to update this just a little bit. So instead of just saying this function executed successfully, we're going to say executed successfully from Terraform. So you'll be able to see that difference if you've ever run this this demo yourself for this built-in function. So here's our configuration here again. What I'm going to do here real quick is actually set this up to go ahead and run. But we need to, right now we're using a beta version of our code. So we're going to set our beta flag to true, and then we're going to go ahead and do a Terraform apply. And so while that's kind of running through, let's walk through some of the changes that are going on behind here. So we still have our basic provider block that's defined, our basic resource group, storage account as well. And then the differences come into our service plan. This is a little bit different. We have still have our OS type and our SKU that's called out there, but it's done in a little bit of a different configuration. Excuse me one second while I hit yes down there. Let our provisioning happen. Then we have our function app declaration here. However, we've updated this to be specific to a Linux function app. So here we can kind of tease out some of those more granular configurations that are built into Azure as part of those Linux-based function applications. The big part here is you can see that we've kind of changed and tweaked out our configuration here, setting it to we have our site config, then the application stack, calling out that we're still using Python 3.9. And then here's the big improvement here. We have a little bit of a long-winded resource name here in the Azure RM function app function, but this actually provisions and publishes that function out to Azure so that we can use it in a more declarative approach. And we can see some of the things that are involved in this configuration here and kind of how it matches up to our function. If we come over here and say, open this to the side, we can see here we have our config JSON that's been implemented there. And we can see how that matches up directly to our bindings over here. And then the same thing for our sample name Azure, because we're giving it the ability to add a name to our function there to have that interaction there. And that's even there with our test data that's there. So down below, we can see that our function is being provisioned and published out to our application that we created. And there we have it. So now we have our function URL, which means that theoretically, we should be able to copy that. And let's just do a simple curl statement. So running that, we can see that the HTTP triggered function executed successfully. But you know, it says, you know, hey, why don't you pass in a name to this? So let's go ahead and do that. Let's enter in some data. We're going to feed it in our name. And let's give it, call it the DevOps lab. So there we have, hello, DevOps lab. The HTTP triggered function executed successfully from Terraform. So you can even see the updated Python script that we were created and using as part of our function is reactive there. We can also call this again and just say, you know, hello, April. So really cool way to kind of run through and start being able to interact with those functions in a more declarative way using Terraform. And of course, we can also go back through and destroy the whole thing just as so.
And then it's get rid of it.
Yes. Fully clean up everything. Like I said, you know, using that anonymous capabilities to hit that. Don't want it to live out there for too long.
And you know, this is great to see because I have deployed functions, logic apps, and the limiter we had was always pulling in the JSON files, et cetera. So this has cleaned it up. You've declared what type of function app you're deploying. So much cleaner. And it is a much more declarative approach because we constantly have people asking, you know, do I want to embed a JSON file in my Terraform? You don't want to. It can be done. It's messy. So this is great to see this come out in the new 3.0 update. So a lot cleaner, a lot nicer.
Absolutely. It's very exciting to be able to, partner together and work on some of this stuff just to make the whole workflow a whole lot better and more streamlined. And then as that's going, it's kicked off enough. So let me show just a couple other things that we'll run through real quick. We've also added some benefits to the function block. So for those of you who have started using the Azure provider already, you're probably familiar with the functions block that's part of the Azure provider block. But here we've added some new capabilities for the Key Vault. So in the 2.0 versions, you were able to, you know, basically manage or remove things from the vault as a whole. So it was either remove vault or, destroy vault. In the 3.0 release, we have also added some capabilities so that now you can tease out and interact with the nested configurations that are there as well. So you can actually, you know, interact with certificates or keys or secrets even so that you can, you know, remove those nested items instead. So it's another really nice capability that's been added to interacting with the Azure Key Vault. And our last big one that I want to show off here is, Azure has this capability of availability zones. And that's something that's been added into the Terraform resources as well here. So when you're working with those resources who can take advantage of those availability zones, they're now here too. So what we're looking at here is an Azure Linux virtual machine resource, and it has this new argument for zone. So we can call out that we really want this to live in, I think this is going to be deployed to like US East. So we want that to go directly to the availability zone 1. And then if we were working with something like a scaling set, we could set that to specific zones. So we could say, you know, zone 1 and 2 or zone 1 and 3 and just be able to, you know, add that additional level of customization and availability to the resources that we're able to provision in Azure.
And this changes the whole kind of availability DR story that we have with customers with virtual machines. You know, we're no longer saying, right, we need to, you know, run Azure backup or another third-party backup. We can literally redeploy this, set our zones, and have that resiliency and redundancy built in. So this is cool to see. I also really like seeing the availability to kind of drill down into Key Vault a little bit further. every project I've been on with customers, we're constantly deploying our keys and our secrets or certificates to Key Vault. So having that granularity control, because we'll set it up, deploy it, and then we have to go into Key Vault and manage it and configure it. So I'm really excited to see Key Vault have a lot more configurability from day one. So this is awesome, Kyle. This is really, really cool.
Yeah, I'm really excited about it too. And I can't wait to get this out into the wild and start seeing everybody start using it and really taking advantage of these things.
So for everyone watching today, we will post links in the show notes for you to look at all the code and get started and look at the cool features with availability zones in your VMs. Look at how you can configure Azure Key Vault a little bit more granularly from Terraform, and then go into deploying functions, which is a huge game changer for looking ways for people to automate in Azure. So Kyle, thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you to HashiCorp for having you back on the show. And thank you everyone for tuning in.